Hello, I missed you guys. Welcome back. It's great to be back. I was MIA for a little while. My son got really sick and he was in the hospital for a little over a week. It's been craziness, especially with this election and everything. I won't get political. I'll just say it was a very good weekend. Now, for those of you who are wondering what exactly went on with my son, I'll give you just a little information. I'll probably end up talking about it more on Patreon, but he was diagnosed with Crohn's disease last year after another crazy whirlwind of a hospitalization. And this past month or so, he's been having some weird symptoms, painful symptoms. And after, oh my gosh, a whole body MRI, bone biopsies, skin biopsies, my poor kid, we found out it is something called CRMO. It's a pretty rare condition, especially rare for boys. It's like 1 in 6 million or so. It stands for chronic recurrent multifocal osteomyelitis, which really means inflammation on your body, in your body, without having an infection. So in my son's case, his bones were really inflamed, especially like his pelvis, his legs, ankles, knees. He was just absolutely in pain. And we got it figured out. We're headed in the right direction for treatment to make his symptoms hopefully go into remission and kind of keep him there. But it was a journey, which leads me to a little revelation, a little story I have in just a bit. But before I get to all that, no, I'm not going to plug Patreon or TRP yet. I want to introduce some new things into each and every episode, because as I was laying on a very uncomfortable hospital couch, many sleepless nights, I got to thinking, and I missed some things that I used to do on every episode when I had more time and there were less crazy TV shows. It was just like the birth of 90 Day Fiance when I started. And I want to get back to one of my favorite things, Would You Rather? So every week, I think what I'll do is I'll wrap up every show with a weekly Would You Rather. And I think this week's is pretty damn good. So look forward to that at the end of the episodes. And then I also want to throw in a fun fact and or prediction every week. I don't know whether it's going to be reality TV related, pop culture. I'm just going to throw them out there. So my fun fact for the week is that Kanye West is 5'8". That is 5'8". Did we know this? I was under the assumption he was a taller man, but something about him being basically my height just makes everything make sense. He's such a twee little man. Okay, don't come after me, Kanye people. I'm just saying, it's pretty interesting, right? 5'8". Okay, my prediction for this week, and maybe I should have probably trademarked this because I guarantee it will happen. 100% certain this is going to happen. You know my hatred of reindeer cars, of Rudolph cars, and people who wear Santa hats, not ironically, wear them for warmth. In the same vein, I am predicting light up face masks. And trust me, it's going to happen. People will have Christmas lights adorned on their face mask. It's going to happen, and I'm going to hate every single one of them. All right, I'm throwing it out there. It's going to be the same people with the Rudolph car wearing the fucking light up mask inside. You're going to hate them just as much as I do when we inevitably see them. I'm already really genuinely upset about this. Okay, my little story for this week is one that is very personal and one that I would never, ever share because I hate bodily function kind of stories because it's disgusting. But this one is just so fascinating that I have to share with you. So if you are typically a Jody with this kind of thing, you may want to jump ahead, 30 seconds. I'm going to keep it very brief because it's truly one of the mysteries of the universe, a mystery of science. Here we go. As many of you who have stayed in a hospital for any amount of time, even a day, a night, will know, you are never alone. There are people in and out of a hospital room probably several hundred times a day. Okay, so just put into account that my son had, five different specialties in and out of the room, rheumatology, infectious disease, GI, endocrinology, who else came through? Orthopedics. I mean, oh, pain management. Oh my God, you guys. He was on so much pain medicine. All I could think of was the Steven Asante episodes where he kept going back in for Dilaudid because my kid was on a constant drip of Dilaudid plus a PCA, which is like one of those trigger things where you could just, you know, pump it when you need it. And he was on a oxycodone and morphine. I mean, I was afraid there was going to be looting downtown Chicago. And the first place everyone was going to go was our hospital room because we were like stocked up to the gills with crazy opioids. Anyhow, my whole point being is there are people in and out of the room all the time. So that doesn't leave much opportunity to use the facilities when you have to, right? So I was there, 9 days. And while they were pumping my kid full of Miralax and Senecot and all this kind of stuff to try to make him go, I was getting worried, like maybe I need to tap them on the shoulder and ask for some for myself. Because you guys, what happened? Like, my body is a wonderland, okay? John Mayer wrote the song about my body. I had no opportunity to go number two. I can't believe I'm telling you this, but I am. There was no opportunity in a day to have the privacy to go to the bathroom that my body reabsorbed everything. It didn't go anywhere. I didn't have to go. I've been home now for a couple days. Everything seems to be normal. Like, I didn't have some big backup. I didn't have some big blowout. It's incredible. Like, I think I was so, I don't know, maybe backed up. Like, I went to the other side. I broke through the other side, the other colon barrier that no one has before. Is that not insane? And I don't show any signs of like sepsis or anything, so I think I'm fine. The other reason my body is a wonderland is my period was due. I know I'm like really going places with you guys. I feel very close to you right now. I was supposed to get my period like 10 days ago, like right smack dab in the middle of this hospital visit. And I didn't get it until after I got home. My body knew. It gave me a gift. It was like, listen, Jody, we're going to just like reabsorb all that shit. I mean, you're going through a lot of shit, so we're just going to reabsorb it. And we're going to give you a break, okay? We're going to lay off the hormones for this month until you get home because you're already going through it and crying enough. We'll have you just save it all up until you get home, and then you can just take it out on Dave then. I know. Fascinating, right? Has anyone else gone through this? Or should I just, I don't know, enroll myself into some medical studies and they can just see what all of this is about? Okay. Well, I mean, there's really no transition there. Let's jump into Married at First Sight before I start telling you other things about my body that you probably don't want to know about, although that was the extent of like all of my secrets I've ever had. So Married at First Sight, I know it wrapped up, but I haven't had a chance to talk to you guys. So I'm going to give you just a little snippet of my thoughts. Woody and Imani, there was no surprises there, right? I mean, they're in love. He gave her this engagement ring, and Imani gave us a complete view of all of her side boob. And normally, I don't really like that look, that super deep cut of the tank top where the boobs are hanging out, but she was rocking it. I like it because she had curves where a lot of times you see, you know, like the wavy models, they do it, and it's like, okay, well, great, you're pretty much flat. You're not really showing us any boob. It's more just armpit. But she was rocking it. I loved it. Karen and Miles, they stayed together. I did see a spoiler that they stayed together. I don't know if I see them going long-term, though. I just think Karen wants a bad boy, and Miles is not that bad boy, but they stayed together for now because they finally had sex. Amelia and Bennett, another couple, no surprises there. They're still together. They still sing their little folksy twee songs, and they're just peeing all over the shower together separately. They just couldn't wait to tell everyone that they just piss all over their own tile. Gross. Now, Brett and Olivia, Henry and Christina, these were our two couples that never could really stand each other. Olivia in these finale episodes was glowing without Brett in the room, breathing all the oxygen with his freaking nose that I swear those nostrils have got to cause twisters to form. You know, he might even be the one that's responsible for all these natural disasters in New Orleans. I'm just saying. End of the day, Olivia looks fantastic and Brett still sucks. Now, Henry and Christina, oh, no surprises, right? Except we found out that Christina was in a relationship, allegedly, with a married man for 5 years before the show. They broke up, and then a couple weeks, couple months later, she signs up for this. She marries Henry. Now, if you noticed in that finale of the finale, whatever that thing's called, reunion, kind of, she never denied that. She just started crying and saying she just wanted to move on and be done with this already. It's just so obvious to me now that Christina is that type of girl. Doesn't she just seem like that mistress type? Yeah, I know I sound like a total bitch saying that, but I just see that quality in her now because she really doesn't seem like the kind of girl that anyone would really want to settle down with because she's so full of drama and she crashed and burned so hard. Because you know she thought she'd come on this season of Married at First Sight. And typically they pick some good-looking guys for the most part, not always. So she thought she was going to nail down some really hot, single, eligible bachelor, make him her husband, and then her married ex-boyfriend would be jealous. You know that was her intention. But instead, she got Henry, who figured her out before they even had the dinner roll served at the reception. She was not expecting that at all. And she got burned. And she really deserved it. All right, now let's talk about... Okay, I gotta talk about Love After Lockup. I've been dying these past couple weeks. I did watch the episodes. And I was itching to record because the season is really, really good. I think this is better than any of the other seasons that we've seen. If you think back to like Jonna and Garrett... Yes, it was the beginning of an era, but we got nowhere near the level of drama and crazy shit that we have now. Speaking of, let's talk about Sean and Destiny first. There's a lot to unpack here. So Destiny knows she's going back to prison because the state's attorney refiled or renewed her charges. And Sean, the genius that he is, sees it as the perfect time to propose to her. You know, he wants to promise his life and the lives of his children, let's be honest, to the woman that the ginormous state of California insists should be behind bars. Now, it's clear to anyone with eyes or ears or a soul, a beating heartbeat, that Destiny does not want to marry this guy. But she knows that she needs someone to put some money on her books, right? So she's going to say yes to Sean. She'll break up with him in the future, probably pawn the ring off. You know, why the hell not? She's only got a number of days of freedom, so just cash the checks and get ready to go hog wild on some honey buns. Now, there is a rare instance where Sean, aka the groom, is seeing himself walking down the aisle. You know, he's caught up in this romantic fantasy. He is the belle of the ball, truly the belle of the ball. Whereas we have the bride, who typically is the one daydreaming about walking down the aisle. But here we have Bride Destiny, who only cares about the party. Let me be clear. She cares about the party she's going to have with her bunkies after Sean sends her money to make probably some pruno, some potty pasta. Destiny, Jesus. Okay, now let's talk about Sean and this brilliant idea of his to have Destiny and his ex Kelly, also mother of his six kids, meet up. Why is this necessary? Because he hears Destiny clearly saying a number of times, I mean, actually the name of this episode is Two Body Bags. He hears Destiny repeatedly saying that she's going to beat up and or kill Kelly or him. So that should be some red flags, like, oh, you know what? Maybe Destiny should calm down a little bit or be locked up. Maybe they could have like a FaceTime call at some point. But I don't see why Sean is insisting on this unless it's to make himself feel good. And this is why Sean is a monster. He's going to enjoy feeling like the macho man, the manly man who's being fought over. He loves this little love triangle he has going on. I don't get it. There's nothing there but some sort of lip issue, some sort of orthodontic needs. And so help me, if Destiny ends up being pregnant. That preview sure as hell implies that, which leads to another question. Why is it teen moms are always the most fertile? Why is it Sean, of all men, have super sperm? I hate all of this. I might be a little shaky speaking about this next couple. That's Heather and Dylan, because Heather truly terrifies me. I think she's probably clinically psychotic. Like, if you pulled out the DSM, what are we on, DSM-5, she would probably check all the boxes. It's either she's psychotic or maybe an and or she's on drugs that make her act like a complete lunatic. And the fact that she makes Dylan look like, you know, Jesus Christ on the cross, Jesus Christ superstar, that's terrifying. Because I know Dylan is getting a lot of, I don't want to say sympathy. Well, maybe sympathy. People like Dylan. They're like, oh, poor Dylan. He seems like such a good guy and he's dealing with her. I get that he appears to be this meek and mild, nice guy so far, but I still do not trust him. Am I the only one? You know, he hasn't earned my trust just because he was polite and congenial with Aunt Diane. That said, I am glad he made it out of the Cadillac alive, because there's no doubt in my mind that Heather would have driven that car either into a pole, oncoming traffic, or Lake Michigan. That's where she was headed for sure. We've all seen stories like this, and it never ends on a happy note. And what's confusing to me most of all, that never really gets talked about or even asked about. Like, a producer at this point, they've broken down the fourth wall. Why didn't they ask Dylan what he meant by he has nowhere else to go? He's talking about how tight he is with his parents, and he talked to his mom all the time, although he couldn't always see her because psycho Heather would always say she monopolized the visits. But he makes a point in saying that he's very close with his mom and dad. But then why is he paroling to Aunt Diane's house? There seems to be something missing to me, and maybe that thing missing is, I'm going to sound like a bitch here, but it is what it is, guys. I think there may be some sobriety issues with his mom and his aunt, because they seem to be a little twitchy to me, perhaps a little lot bit twitchy and a little too touchy-feely too. You know, I have a son. I don't think I would ever reach across the table and caress my son's hands like that. Like, his mom strikes me as the type of mom who would be like, my son would never do that when he'd get in trouble as a youngster. Oh my God, I just said youngster. It just goes to show you that I'm not a youngster anymore. But, you know, he would be the type of kid who could turn on the charm and she would believe anything and everything he would tell her and call everyone else liars, like an Eddie Haskell type of kid. How's that for a fresh take, you guys? Another real current reference I have going on here, Eddie Haskell. Leave it to Beaver. I think I probably just lost everyone below the age of 40. But if you know what I'm saying, you know what I'm saying. Now, Maurice and Jessica, another couple where there's a family dynamic we are missing. We're not getting the full picture. So in this episode, Jessica is going wedding dress shopping. And in the previous episode, she found out she's pregnant. Maurice spilled the beans very quickly to her dad. And we are supposed to believe no one knows she's pregnant. And we're also supposed to believe that Jessica hasn't talked to her sister simply because she was dating Maurice when he was locked up. That's what Jessica claims. But there's something about the fact that Jessica's mom is able to maintain what seems like a very good relationship with both Jessica and this stubborn sister. That leads me to believe there's something Jessica either did or does that allows Mother Jessica to see both sides, if that makes any kind of sense. Like, I'm just thinking, okay, I have two sisters and a brother, and there are definitely times when we've been on the outs with each other and actually about more serious kinds of things. And although my siblings and I have a great relationship with my mom individually, even when we've had those times where we weren't getting along, she would try to have us see the other person's point of view, or if we were wrong, she would point that out. I guess what I'm trying to get at is I think Jessica probably did or does something that her mom understands why her sister doesn't really want to talk to her. Does that make any kind of sense? It's hard to be specific and be very clear when we don't really know what the whole picture is. But her mom also seems like the kind of person who's just kind of whatever or beige to everything. Like she can coast through life very easily without taking a side on anything or not even being surprised by much. Because think about when Jessica croaked out with that cheese grater voice of hers that she was pregnant. Her mom didn't seem all that surprised. She was like, oh, okay, sure. Okay, great. I'm a grandma. Let's keep shopping. I was expecting a bigger reaction. Although, let's be honest, her husband probably told her immediately as soon as Maurice and Jessica left their house, right? No one can keep that kind of secret. But one thing we do know for sure, Jessica's parents are incredibly loving, very supportive, some might argue to a fault, because nothing can stop them from yes-anding anything and everything Jessica does, which is nice to see, but also it makes me wonder what kind of lies beneath. You know, what are the skeletons in the closet there? There's a lot we don't know and a lot I hope we find out if the sister comes to the wedding, which it looks like she does. I just want to know a lot more about that. If anyone knows, please share the details with all of us in the Facebook group. Okay, Quaylon and Chevelle. Quaylon has left Chevelle in Kansas City about a week ago as we're watching this. And if you remember, he bought that one-way ticket to, Texas. Well, it wasn't Kansas City. And he's just living his best life, which I'm all for because he's been incarcerated for a very long time. He should be able to go see his family, go have some cocktails, go and visit, whatever. But I do think buying a one-way ticket is pretty shitty. Now, his sister, she sure likes to stir some shit up. She sets Quaylon up with her friend who, hands down, out of anyone I've ever compared to a Hanna-Barbera cartoon, I apologize because really this chick, her name needs to be legally changed to Hanna-Barbera. Her confirmation name at the very least. I mean, the level of chin to jaw to cheek ratio, very close to my own. I probably look like a Hanna-Barbera cartoon. I'm not going to deny it. But when I saw Hanna walk in there looking like a busted Barbie in the rockers, see something, say something. And I'm going to say some more about her eyeshadow here. What is that look exactly? Because the purple eyeshadow was not even on her eyes. It looked like there was purple smoke coming out of her damn temples. And it looked so ridiculous. Now, Quaylon, also ridiculous, because he's making Chevelle look like such an asshole. He's making it look like she's stalking him. I think, I'm going to take Chevelle's side on here. I think she's just curious if, you know, he's going to fly back and live with her and marry her like he said he was going to do for quite a few years now. And maybe she's calling him nonstop because he's not ever picking up his damn phone. Now, I want to shake some sense into Chevelle and say, move on, because she's boohooing about a guy that clearly wants to live in wherever he is. Again, Texas, not Kansas City. But she's hanging on to what she thought she was going to have. And instead, she should concentrate on not asking her daughter if she wants a dad. Hey, you miss Quaylon? Are you going to be devastated that he's not coming back? No, girl. If your daughter is going to be so hurt that Quaylon is not her daddy, that's your own damn fault. Because you should not be having your kid call someone daddy before they actually meet. And to be honest, Myla didn't seem too heartbroken when Chevelle was asking her about Quaylon. And I think she said something like, Quaylon, is that the guy that's your boyfriend? That sounds a lot different than, you mean daddy? She doesn't give a shit. She doesn't care if Quaylon's around or not, you know? Now, the sisters, I think they are doing Chevelle and Quaylon quite dirty because they know what they're doing. They know they want to just fuck some shit up. And at the end of the day, even if they're wanting better for their brother, they're going to make his life a living hell for at least a little period in time, and he didn't seem that interested in Hannah, you know? I don't see those two together anyway. He seems a little short and squatty. Like, he would be, I don't know the name, he'd be like that little cartoon character dog that's someone's little pet in the Hanna-Barbera cartoon universe. Okay, I'm going to have to revisit that. But let's talk about John and Christiana. Oh, God, they're so cringy, but I can't wait to talk about them. John in his Bonnie and Clyde fascination. You know what he shouldn't do if he's trying to keep Christiana safe? Like, he doesn't want to draw attention to them. He's trying to evade the police rearresting Christiana. But he's driving around in a truck that's got Bonnie and Clyde printed in huge cursive font on the rear view window, or not the rear view window, the rear window of his truck. Like, he really gets turned on by this comparison, which is the weirdest thing to me, because Christiana might be Bonnie, but John is two braids and I'm going to say about a foot and a half shy of any kind of Clyde that I know of. And would it kill John to get a little bit of sunlight on his skin? Like, I know they're living in Nebraska or South Dakota or somewhere that doesn't get a whole lot of sunshine. But, you know, when John makes my kid, who is anemic right now, my kid looks like Pauly D next to John, okay? He's got this sallow skin, that stank-ass, stinky suede jacket. Like, there's no doubt in my mind that John smells like mildew. You know, like when your laundry is in your washing machine, you forget to switch it over for like 2 days into the dryer. That smell plus a basement mustiness mixed with smoker's breath or whatever he's breathing off that vape or that pipe that he can never fucking put down. And you know, he thinks he looks all cool and badass sucking on that thing. But Christiana, she's in a tough spot here because she knows that she's going to have to put out before she turns herself in. So she has John go and get a bottle of wine. She's going to guzzle that thing, close her eyes. And I think she kept those camera guys around until the very last moment when she had to be alone with John. I mean, ugh. Out of all the men on this season of Love After Lockup, I think John is the one. You couldn't pay me enough to sleep with John. Even to have a conversation with him, I wouldn't be able to do it. Just that, again, that mildewy stank in the air around him. Like, I feel like I would be able to taste it. I could taste how bad his space smells. And speaking of space, okay, Christiana. She wants a whole lot of it. So much space that, you know, maybe there wouldn't be enough in a cell. So now she's decided that she's going to wait a day to turn herself in. If and when she turns herself in, she wants to be ready for it. So after this evening full of mildewy ecstasy, she wants to spend another day with her mom and her sister. Now, I don't totally understand how this works because they know Christiana and John are married, maybe. Like, did the halfway house know that they were married? And if they're married or they are together, John being a contact of some sort when she was in that halfway house, wouldn't the police have a bit of a lead, like where she might be? And then he would get in trouble if she were arrested there. Something is not all there for me. I'm unclear about it. But, you know, Christiana's sister, the one with the methy looking face, she's openly admitting she's going to call the sheriff on Christiana. So I think in that case, like, it might be best to turn yourself in, because if she's looking like the voice of reason, yikes. And at the very least, Christiana's going to get out of having to sleep with John one more time that night. Because, you know, that's the only reason that he's like, yeah, I think it's best. You know, she needs to be mentally ready before she goes into jail. Okay, braids, pipe down, literally pipe down on your vape there and let Christiana and her family figure this out, because they're probably going to be taking squatter's rights to John's house pretty soon. He's in way over his greasy, unbrushed head. Now, Scott and Lindsey. We got barely any footage of them this week, but it was so good. Now, Lindsey has more secrets than we originally knew. This secret's name is Tara Bell. Take a moment there. Tara Bell. Thank you, God. Thank you, Cara Berry, for also hearing this and seeing this and picking up that Tara Bell's name is terrible. Terrible. Her parents were so terribly stupid that they named their kid Tara Bell. And she's also stupid because if I were named Tara Bell, I'd be dropping that bell as soon as possible. Why isn't she just going by Tara? So bad. Tara Bell, God. All right, so Tara Bell arrives on the yard, which we all know Lindsey can't go any further than me because she's got her ankle bracelet. And they embraced each other. And as soon as they hugged, just a second too long, just a millimeter too close, I was like, So they're that kind of special friend, friends with benefits. And then we saw them close talking in Miley Cyrus's room. And I was like, okay, Scott's going to be very pissed this is going on because clearly they are lovers of some sort. No shade on that, just shady because, you know, she's in a relationship. And we did get previews of them making out and all that, but I want to go back to Miley Cyrus or Miley Grace's room. I thought she was in a room off the garage, but this looks like a room above the garage, as in an attic. It didn't look like it had any proper ventilation. And just think about little Miley Grace in the morning coming on down, like having to release a trapdoor to go down or to pull the ladder down, like in Christmas Vacation. You know, just pull that thing down, have it hit you in the head, then go up there until mommy remembers that you're up there, because let's face it, that's exactly what's going to happen. I'm very concerned about that attic up there. There's probably some sort of illegal insulation. Who knows what the electrical is if Scott's up to it? I mean, look what he did to his own lip with a pen cap. By the way, that's my own theory. I've gotten so many DMs like, where did you learn about his lip and the pen cap? That's my theory. He chewed on a pen one time and my brain just went crazy. And I assume he was twisting and chewing and he got his lip stuck in the pen cap, obviously. Okay, so Tara Bell and Lindsey are just going to like go at it in Miley Grace's room, which I'm sure she's going to be thrilled about when she gets to move in and know that mommy slept with the terrible on the floor there. Hopefully it's not as terrible as it was on the floor with Scott. Ba-dum-bum-ching. Okay, let's all take a breather here, a breath of fresh air outside the attic, and then let's jump into 90 Day Fiance The Other Way. Well, what do you know? The fine people at Ritual must be listening to RealiTV because I have been openly wishing, hoping, crossing my fingers, Ritual would extend their line of multivitamins, and they have. You already know I take my two Ritual Essential for Women every morning, and I got my husband on the Men's Essential bandwagon too. I am pumped and so excited that Ritual has extended their product line of clean vitamins to pre and postnatal and the all-new Essential for Teens, Him and Her. Researched and designed to fill in the gaps in both boys' and girls' diets, Ritual makes sure to be totally transparent in their sourcing with no fillers, no additives, no preservatives, sweeteners, or colorants. You don't have to lay out a whole bunch of capsules or suspensions or even powders anymore. Just two capsules that stay minty fresh in the bottle thanks to this awesome little tab inside each one. You got your iron, vitamin D, omega-3 DHAs, just to name a few. And if you ever try to get your kid or teen to take omega-3s, you know the struggle. They taste like crap because most of them are fish oil, or you're paying a lot of money for those refrigerated kinds that come in the yummy flavored bottles. You know what I'm talking about. They cost an arm and a leg at the health food stores. You wouldn't really know that I'm kind of a vitamin and supplement nerd, but it's confession time. I am. You know, with all the different things my kids go through, I'm always trying new things, making sure I supplement what I know I'm lacking in cooking for them and their diets. So speaking from experience and being disappointed several times, I don't think multivitamins should be something that you order from Amazon. You know, Ritual is my go-to because they're always on time. I never run out. I know exactly what is in each capsule, clean, quality ingredients, and I save money on shipping now because I can bundle my order. My multivitamins, Dave's, now the kids. I'm telling you, you are going to love Ritual as much as we do in my house. Just a dollar a day to have all the essential nutrients your body needs right to your door, no strings attached. And right now, Ritual is offering my listeners 10% off your first 3 months. Try it out, satisfaction guaranteed. Go to ritual.com/realiTV to start your ritual today. That's 10% off during your first 3 months at ritual.com/realiTV. Check the link in the show notes and get started. All right, well, 90 Day Fiance is always a balance, and this latest episode of The Other Way, entitled Fight or Flight, was exactly that. We had four couples with pretty boring storylines, and then, whoa, we had Brittany and Yazin that, I mean, you can't even say it's dramatic. It's truly life and death shit that comes up. Wild. So I'm going to save them for last just so I don't get myself into a panic attack or an asthma attack because she really pissed probably the whole world off as we're watching this. Now, first, let's get Jenny and Sumit out of the way because we didn't really see much of them. We know that Sumit's divorce is final and Jenny wants to plan this ring ceremony, which is kind of like a pre-wedding, pre-engagement celebration. And all she wants to do is throw a party and dress up and dance. And if Jenny doesn't remind you of Phyllis Vance Refrigeration from The Office right now, I don't know if we are watching the same show right now. And I don't know if we can be friends because Jenny and Phyllis and Jenny, they are one of the same. And she's a hell of a bowler. Okay, so that's about it. I mean, basically, they're in lockdown. Sumit has to be careful because he's diabetic, and Jenny has to be careful because she's old. Sumit definitely wants us to know Jenny's old. Old dusty bones over there. She better stay inside during this quarantine or else she's going to be crossing bones. Okay, Jihoon and Devin. This one's tough. Devin had a miscarriage. I remember reading about this months ago. And I'm not going to judge her reaction or how she's dealing with it because that's a devastating loss, plain and simple. So I'm going to let Devin off the hook this week. I'm not going to shame her for her shaming Jihoon for being a totally normal guy who looks at naked girls' boobs because it's totally normal. The Modern History Museum visit with Jihoon's mom, it was funny and it was sweet. I could have used more of it, but I'm sure it was pretty difficult with the language there. But turns out Mother Jihoon, she's got a heart, maybe even a soul down there. I think she might even be a bit of a feminist, if I do dare say so. I'm rooting for her. I have some hope for Mother Jihoon. All right, Tim and Melissa. Tim's mom named Robin and his aunt Carmen, who has a weird spelling just like Melissa. Lots of extra Y's and M's and Z's everywhere. Well, they've come down to visit Tim in Colombia and kind of see what's going on with this relationship, if it's a good idea for Tim to stay there or not. So Melissa has made some plans for herself to stay at her parents' house while his aunt and his mom are visiting, which I thought was perfectly reasonable. But Tim's mom threatened to call the cops on Melissa months or years ago. So there's some tension there that we didn't know about. Like, they are not besties. It's not like this mother and daughter-in-law relationship where they're going to go shopping and they're going to wrap presents together and go out for girls' nights. They don't have that kind of relationship. So I think Melissa is really damned either way. You know, she's either going to be living and walking on eggshells for the entire visit if she stays, or if she goes like she did, they're going to call her basically a cold bitch. You know, why is she leaving? She doesn't want to spend time with us. She's fucked either way. I'm 100% behind her leaving the house. It's doing them a favor because going back to my body is a wonderland revelation, Who wants to take a shit with their in-laws in the house? Because that's basically what it is. And I'm talking about Tim's mom and aunt. Wouldn't they be more comfortable walking around, taking a shower, going back to their room, taking a shit, changing into their bras or swimsuits or whatever the hell when they don't have Melissa walking around the house? Anyway, at the end of the episode, they have a little bonding moment at the market. I think it really doesn't matter because they both need to realize not every mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, or potential mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, you don't have to be best gal pals. You don't have to be best friends. Actually, I don't even know of anyone that I'm really close to that has a super, super tight bond with their mother-in-law or father-in-law. Like, they get along, but it's not as if they have to be best friends. So I think it's a little overreaching or unrealistic for them to think they have to be or they have to get to a place where they have to be besties. Okay, let's move on to Ariella and Binyam. Ariella. Welcome to motherhood. She is figuring out what it means to have a newborn baby. And for everyone, I don't care who you are, where you live, every new mom is going to be tired, irritable, and maybe jealous of, well, maybe your spouse, maybe friends. I know I was jealous of other people who could just like get up and go. Even those other moms who had babies that were a lot easier than mine. You know, it's a lot of feelings going on in new motherhood, and everyone wants help that doesn't exist. Truly, those moments when it's just you and the baby, everyone could use a hand and it's not always there, but it does get better. What I'm trying to say is Ariella isn't in that unique of a situation when it comes down to it. You know what I mean? Now, the thing that would annoy me the most, more than Binyam working at a club, which really bothers Ariella, I have a feeling that there's some previous cheating going on, which is why she's so suspicious of him. But there's something else that would annoy me more than where he works, and that would be people stopping by my house unannounced. He's got friends and family popping by all the time. And even thinking about it, my anxiety level, oh my God, I would be at a code red 24/7. If I'm at home, I consider that like when you're playing tag, like what's base? You can't tag me when I'm home. Don't call me. Don't expect me to get back to you right away. And by all means, do not come to my house. Do not ring my doorbell. If a doorbell rings at my house, every one of us, we all freeze. We drop to the floor. We avoid windows and doors. Like, no one should know that we are at home, ever. We go into essentially a lockdown. Like, we stay out of sight. We don't walk around. We don't want people hearing that we have footsteps in the house because that means that we're home. And that means that we're being rude and I'm a coward and I'm not just going to say, can you please just read the sign, no soliciting, because I'm a huge wuss and I'm a wimp and I will hear a whole sales speech and I don't want it, which is why we go silent and no one comes out until I give the all clear code word. And we do have one, but I can't tell you what it is because you're not in the Huff family. We have two special code words. One, when they're at a friend's house and they want to come home, but they can't really say it. And the other, when there's an all clear moment. Yeah, we've had some drop by visitors. I'm not going to go into it because, you know, I love my family. You guys, if you're listening, I love you. Okay, anyway, let's go back to Ariella. So they're stopping by all the time. She's got a newborn. Add that in. Hell no. Ugh. Someone better have a plan B if they're planning on coming to my house and staying, because I'm not letting anyone else in. I'm not letting them in. No way. Although, Ariella and Binyam probably shouldn't worry that much because the toilet seat situation. Why aren't people talking about this? Because I did go on the Twitter very briefly. No one's talking about this toilet seat situation. They had a toilet. Great indoor plumbing, way better than what they had at some of those other Airbnbs, but there was no toilet seat on it. That's one way not to have any guests stop over, but let's just talk about this for a moment. How long did they go without a seat? Because it seems to me pretty impossible that you could do anything that you needed to do on that toilet. Like, the contact and surface area or lack thereof of a toilet without a seat? Is this like a situation where Ariella and Binyam were having to squat all the time? Because I could see that for a pee, but that's going to be a challenge even for the best of CrossFitters if you have to do a number two with no seat. And this toilet that Binyam is finally fixing, he is fucking elbow deep in this thing. It was so disgusting. Why wasn't anyone talking about this? Oh, he's grabbing the toilet around the edges, like the inner edges. He's like fingering the nooks and crannies. What? I wouldn't trust him just for that. I couldn't sleep with nor be friends with someone who can manhandle a toilet like that. He fisted the toilet, basically. Like, his fist was, like, down in there. And then he starts touching his phone, pulling up all of his contacts. And then, did you see the screwdriver? He was mouthing that thing like it was a freaking lollipop. He had it up in there, like, sucking on it, chewing on it. And then Ariella, sorry, I'm banging things around. I'm getting very worked up about this. Ariella takes the phone from him after the toilet to phone transfer of germs. I mean, if he's cheating, let the girls have him. Let the other chicks have him, Ariella. Let them get E. coli and whatever contagious shit-titis of the mouth and hand, foot, mouth disease, whatever he's given them. Think about how a black light would light up Binyam's face like a freaking hotel room after spring break. That nasty ass motherfucker. Ew. And he's holding the baby. Okay. Oh, whatever. Where are we? Oh, right. Okay. Binyam, guys, I think deep down he's a nice person, a good person. Like, I don't think he's going to murder, but I think Binyam can be a manipulator. You know, he knows how to baby talk his way out of shit. And that's exactly what I think he did when he bailed on Ariella. He didn't think it was going to be a big deal because he knows that when he's done it before, it worked. He just get his little baby voice on and he could get through the day without bringing it up, without having a fight. And then last minute, he's going to drop it on her and it doesn't give her enough time to go off on him the way that she deserves to go off on him. You know, he's immature, but I think she is kind of more in the wrong only because she's expecting him to be someone that he's not, to be a complete other person than he ever has been. He's the same person that she met. Remember, she was the one who catcalled him from across the street. So how is she expecting him to just change suddenly? Now, her parents arrive, and they truly do seem like the sweetest people. You know, they welcome Binyam. They told him to call them mom and dad. Dr. Weinberg didn't even scoff at the roses like Angela from The Office or I would have done. That's a good guy. You know, I would have been like, what am I supposed to do with this? Thanks. Thanks for the job you just gave me. Now I got to find a vase in the middle of an Ethiopian hotel. I'm joking. That was actually very sweet. A little weird, but that was sweet. Oh, where are we? Oh, right. Okay, so they show up and they're excited to see the baby. I mean, the baby looks exactly like Ariella and her dad. It's pretty wild. I think her parents like Binyam more than Ariella does at this point. You know, they know that Binyam's not going to be this white-collar corporate type that Ariella now wants him to be. So they're just being kind to him. They're just being kind at the very least. I don't think they were really that bothered that he had to go to work and dance and sing or play the butt bongos, whatever it was that he had to do. And it wouldn't bother me if I were them, just like the Melissa situation. You know, they're probably going to go to sleep anyway. And with him gone, it's more time they can have with the baby and their daughter, and they can just be more relaxed and open and honest, right? I think Arielle is the one who's mad and she's just using her parents, you know, potentially thinking that he's an asshole because he has to work as an excuse for her to just be so upset about it. All right, DeBella DeBall, Brittany, whoa. Brittany has, I was going to say maybe, but I think she clearly is. She's surpassed Lita in the most narcissistic and evil woman on this show. When she said, he doesn't see the worth in me. Bitch. The guy is homeless now. He's basically carless. He's about to be murdered by his own father. And you're saying he doesn't see the worth in you? Yasin is not the brightest, sure. I mean, he isn't picking up on the very obvious clues that Brittany isn't going to ever convert religions or become this modest Jordanian housewife. But still, fuck Brittany. I'm thinking as a mother when I watch Brittany, because she comes off very immature, but I'm also looking at her like, if I were watching this show and Brittany were my daughter, I would be furious at how stupid she is acting and the ignorant things she is saying and just how selfish she is and how blind. I was literally blind when we get to the airport, but I mean, really, it would be so disappointing and so embarrassing to watch this if you were her family members, especially her parents. Now, when she gets to the airport and completely misses Yasin, who is also looking for her, if this weren't a life and death scenario, I'm not laughing at it being life or death. I'm laughing at it because it would make for the perfect romantic comedy twist, like a very Sleepless in Seattle moment. Be like, jealous in Jordan or jaded in Jordan. I don't know. Just let the kids stay alive in Jordan. We can workshop a title, but it was a priceless moment. priceless for us, of course. They're both pissed off at each other, thinking the other one stood them up. And this is where we meet Angela. Truly an angel. I have grown to love Angela here. Angela is Brittany's friend who flew to Jordan to meet Yasin. And this poor girl, we find out just before she boarded the flight, Brittany starts blowing up her phone saying she and Yasin are breaking up. And immediately, just at that and that alone, I was like, oh, fuck. It sucks to be that person that's going to be stuck with your friend 24/7 after she and her boyfriend broke up and they're fighting and making up and breaking up. That's going to suck. Now, let's talk about Brittany welcoming Angela into her amazing hotel room as if she were Mariah Carey on Cribs. Double queen beds, a mini fridge. Okay, Brittany, that comes basic standard with the room. All right, that's not an upgrade. Time to cool it because you look ridiculous. And she's on a whole other level, even for her friend. Now, the friend sees Brittany going off on Yasin for the first time. And you could see the moment when she was like, oh, shit, my friend is the crazy one. It's not Yasin. This bitch is crazy. And now I'm stuck here in this country. She's going to get me killed too. So after Brittany hangs up on Yasin, she's like, you know, he seems pretty upset. You know, maybe he has some bigger things going on, you know, like stopping his own murder plot. But Brittany, the girl boss, the travel guru she is, she's not going to let Yasin nor societal norms tell her what to do. So the next day, this bitch puts on sandals, open-toe shoes, a boob shirt, classic boob shirt like you would wear to the club, and they go to this public market, and Angela shows up. Oh God, I love her. As soon as she showed up with that turtleneck and that flawless makeup face, I was like, oh yeah, I totally see you, Angela. I understand you. Angela is the smart friend. You know, everyone's got that friend in their friend group that is like the, I don't want to say mother, but like the big sister. She's the one who becomes the babysitter when everyone's getting drunk. She's just very level-headed. She's Brittany's savior. So the more time Angela is with Brittany and the more time she spends watching Brittany make a fool of herself in that damn market, putting herself in very dangerous situations, like, you know, throwing her boobs around when she's screaming back at the guy saying, no, you're a sin. And then getting wasted on warm rum, the collage of tragic decisions that Brittany has made all comes together for Angela. And she sees this is just a mess, that Brittany has no business visiting Jordan, let alone moving there and marrying a conservative man from there. In the great words of Julia Roberts, big mistake, huge. All right, let's get to our weekly Would You Rather new segment. All right, would you rather be adult Brittany's big brother or sister from the Big Brother Big Sister program, or would you rather pledge a sorority where your hazing is having Brett from Married at First Sight critique your body and personality, and you are not allowed to respond to him? Adult Brittany's big brother, big sister, or pledge a sorority where you are hazed, having Brett critique your body and or personality, you cannot respond. Okay, discuss amongst yourselves in the Facebook group. Let me know what you think. Now, coming up on Patreon and Total Request Podcast this week, you are getting, a whole bunch of shows coming up. Get ready for this. You are getting a Teen Mom 2 crossover of the last couple episodes of Teen Mom 2. Amanda is going to be reading another chapter of Matt Baier's book. We are doing a crossover of season 2 of Unsolved Mysteries, our theories and our opinions on some of these cases. And get ready, announcement time. Moving forward at Patreon tiers 2 and above, we're going to be recapping weekly episodes of Real Housewives of Salt Lake City. Yep, get excited for it. That starts, the first episode is this week, November 11th. So new episode this week. That's a lot. That's like 4 Patreon episodes. Coming up on Told to Request Podcast, a show I have never seen that is a cult classic, one season wonder on Bravo, Princesses of Long Island. We'll be watching that at the $4 level. And on the $6 episode, we are getting all Thanksgiving festive-y. We're always hungry. We are going to be watching the Thanksgiving episode of Friends, The One with the Rumor, which features Brad Pitt. So check that out. All of the links for Patreon, my sponsor, everything's in the show notes. And until next time, you guys, have a great week. Keep wearing those masks and stay salty.